Education in today's world is not just teaching and learning within the four walls of a classroom. It is about creating awareness. Good evening, everyone. On behalf of W.H. Smith Memorial School, I welcome everyone to the webinar. It is absolutely wonderful to have you all with us in the brainstorming session on global warming. I request Mrs. Pratyasha Mukherjee, the great grandniece of Mr. William Henry Smith, and Mrs. Cecilia Rose Smith, the founders of W.H. Smith Memorial School, to formally welcome our eminent guest, Professor Dr. Mallika Arjun Joshi, Dean, Faculty of Science, Department of Geology, BHU. Over to you, Pratyasha ma'am.
Good evening to one and all. On behalf of W.H. Smith Memorial School, I would like to extend a warm welcome to our eminent guest and keynote speaker, Professor Dr. Mallika Arjun Joshi ji, Dean, Faculty of Science, Department of Geology, Banaras Hindu University. Sir, we are honored to have you here. I would also like to welcome all our students and all our viewers. It will definitely be a great learning experience for all of us. Global warming is a phenomenon which is affecting all of us. We may or may not realize it, but global warming is making a huge impact on our lifestyles, and it is sad to say that this impact is not a positive one. We at Smith School realized the urgency of waking up and acting towards slowing down climate change and global warming. Some of the steps that we took were massive tree plantation. In collaboration with Rotary Club Varanasi South, our school planted 5,000 trees in Naugar, Chandauli district. Just to name a few, our school conducted tree plantation programs in Vasanta College, Rajghat, Homeopathy College, Shivpur, and at Panchvati Cantonment. Since a small step matters the most, we have made it a regular practice to gift small saplings in place of glass or plastic gifts to the guests who visit our school in order to encourage tree plantation. Our school has strong ties with OSCA International, a Japanese NGO, and in collaboration with them, a student exchange program was organized in which a group of our students went to Kyoto, Japan, and learned techniques about river cleaning and waste management. When they returned back, they were given the name Green Ambassadors. They went from class to class teaching other students about what they had learned. Under the same program, our school, along with OSCA International, adopted Janki Ghat. Before the pandemic, the school organized trips for students to go and clean Janki Ghat. Since at Smith's, we believe in walking the talk, our school manager, Sir Mr. Pradeep Kumar Day, has undertaken a massive rainwater harvesting project. He has gotten built a massive 20,000 liter tank within the school premises, which will collect water from the rooftop during rains and therefore replenish the groundwater table. This is just a glimpse of the steps that our school is taking from the last few years to spread awareness that global warming is a real phenomenon and it can be stopped by taking small initiatives like this. Further, I will not keep you waiting as we all are eager to listen to Sir. Once again, I welcome Sir and each and everyone, and I hope that this webinar would benefit each and every one of us. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. I now invite Ms. Deboshri Mukherjee to introduce our guest speaker.
Thank you, ma'am.
Deboshri ma'am.
Kirti ma'am, please continue.
So,
thank you, ma'am.
Yes, Devoshi ma'am, please.
Success is not always about greatness. It's about consistency. Consistent hard work leads to success. Among us, today we have an eminent guest, Dr. Mallikarjun Joshi, Professor of Geology, Faculty of Science, Banaras Hindu University, Varanasi. I take privilege to introduce Dr. Joshi to our students and parents who are virtually connected with us today. Dr. Mallikarjun Joshi has completed his master's degree in science in 1977, as well as his doctorate in philosophy in 1984 from Banaras Hindu University, Varanasi. Sir has an experience of teaching graduate and postgraduate classes for the past 36 years. He has worked as a geologist for the Geological Survey of India from 1980 to 85. He has been a lecturer in Department of Geology, Humayun University, Nainital from the year 1985 to 1990. Sir has also had the privilege to work as a reader in Applied Geology, Department of Civil Engineering, Institute of Technology, Banaras Hindu University from the year 1990 to 97. Currently, sir is working in the Department of Geology, Faculty of Science, Banaras Hindu University since 1997. He has also had the privilege of visiting University of Calgary, Canada and has achieved NSA Exchange Award in the year 1989 and National Mineral Award in 1994. Sir is specialized in the field of metamorphic petrology, structural geology and igneous petrology. He also excels in the field of tectonics, mineralogy, geochemistry and optical mineralogy. He has commands over engineering geology, environmental geology and ceramic raw materials. His valuable research include metamorphic petrology, structural geology and tectonics. Sir is currently pursuing his research in metamorphic evolution of Himalaya and resolution of Himalayan and pre-Himalayan structural and metamorphic signatures. I welcome you, sir, on behalf of the entire Smith family and request you to address our inquisitive students.
Can I start?
Yes, sir. Please.
So thank you very much, Ms. Pratyasha and Ms. Devoshi. And I'm grateful to the Smith Memorial School for inviting me for this particular talk. I'm really apologetic because I could not do it yesterday. And even today, I'll have to leave, I think, 5-10 minutes before because I have little control over my time. At any rate, I'm greatly impressed by the initiative in the area of environment the Smith School is taking. Today what I want to talk about is the flip side, or that is the another side of the, what we say, anthropogenic carbon dioxide driven global warming. Anthropogenic is man-made, obviously carbon dioxide driven, and global warming. That means whether the global warming is directly affected by the carbon dioxide produced by humans or not. I might caution you that this is a counterpoint, and maybe that you hear things which you have not heard earlier, but it is very important in science to know about the both the aspects of science. I'll very quickly because I'm addressing a younger audience. See, one thing is important which all of us must realize, and that is the science is not as objective as you presume, or the way it is taught in the schools, even in the universities or colleges, because the way it is taught to us, it is taught to us in a manner as if this was some sort of a sacred truth. That is not the fact. In science, there are opinions, pros and cons, that is opinions for and against, like you people address your debates in the schools. So the opinion on carbon dioxide is also highly divided. Now, there's one word which appears here by the name of the environment establishment science. Establishment science is the one which the governments of many countries want to sort of push or pursue. So this man-made carbon dioxide-driven global warming is essentially the government's view in many places. In many places, this is also a radical view. There's an enormous intertwining of philosophy, politics, and n number of things. I'm not going into those details. I'm not pursuing this window any further because I think it will sort of slightly overlaps the students that we are addressing. But I would like to say that a few things before that. Now, it depends on the duration of time that you are observing. All the observation on which most of the present day scientists are talking is on a very small scale time. That is, they talk of only a few centuries here. But if we make this window larger, that means if we try to look at the whole thing in a much larger fashion. Why a much larger way? Simply because this planet Earth has been here a good 4.6 billion years. And observations of 100, 150 years cannot tell you what has been happening all the way through. So the point is that we as geologists, what we do is we try to unravel what was happening in the geological past. So I would like to present what is my perception, and it is also a perception of a very large number of scientists the world over, not only geologists, even others also. Certainty that prevails that carbon dioxide is responsible for global warming is perhaps not correct. Okay, so I will go to other things, but before that, I'll begin with something which is perhaps the most lethal or most dangerous curve in the history of science as far as 20th century is concerned. Now, let us leave at the moment what happened to Galileo and Bruno and the likes when they were in conflict with the church. Science in many ways runs head on into religious institutions. It could be a temple, it could be a church, it could be any or other sorts of religions generally. But here, what I'm talking is that, leaving those historical debates, I'm giving you a concrete example that what was happening. This graph, I think all of you are fully aware of how to read the graphs. What you can see that this is this is the median line, or you can say that this is the average temperature as it was generally presumed. This gentleman et al. In 1999, they made a graph, or they prepared a graph from the data available to them, and that they demonstrated that the temperatures were below this so-called 0.0 degree. And then suddenly somewhere in the beginning of the 19th century, they started rising up and up and up. So this was a trick that was played by statisticians. And then, as some of you might have heard, that there is a saying in statistics that there are lies, damn lies, and statistics. The data of statistics can be presented in n number of ways. The same data can be shown to demonstrate that the economy is progressing. The same data can be used to demonstrate that the same economy is regressing. This is. But for all these things, we will be sort of taking some guidance from the intellectual stalwarts. Noam Chomsky presently the and that is our self-assigned responsibility. That is, if you are an intellectual, what is an intellectual? Most of you with feeling that if I have a PhD degree, I'm an intellectual. No. Sorry, friends, I'm not at all intellectual if I just have a degree. Intellectual is one who reacts to the society with a degree or without a degree. But the power of the government propaganda apparatus is such that the citizen who does not undertake a research project on a subject can hardly hope to confront government pronouncement with the fact. If the government says that it is CO2 which is responsible, you believe it. If the government says that economy is progressing, you believe it. And any number of things. So, and Chomsky is one of the greatest American scholars, in fact, the global scholars, of course, based in America, he said this. We come with another example, almost more than half a century before that. And this is our own Albert Einstein. I say because this is he's a scientist. Now see every line that he says very carefully. Moreover, under existing conditions, he is saying this in 1949. Moreover, under existing conditions, private capitalists inevitably control directly or indirectly the main sources of information: press, radio, education, ad, TV. It is thus extremely difficult and indeed in most cases quite impossible for the individual citizen to come to objective conclusions and to make intelligent use of his political right. This is a scientist. So the greatest of the social scientists and the greatest of scientists are saying the same thing. You will not hear these things. That's why I'm here. Yet another great scholar of the 19th century, in the book known as Grundrisse, he writes, "Let the quoter, the excerptor beware. Beneath these choppy waters are reefs to sink many a hasty cargo of interpretation." So we'll keep these things in mind and go ahead. Now this is a cartoon, and obviously it is not a cartoon, because it shows that what happens to climate computer models here when they confront a geological history. Now climate computer models are simulations made on computer, and the cartoon shows that when they confront, this is made a ship made of wood, an old ship, and when they confront solid rock of geological history, you can understand the fate of these global climate computer models. Now this is a graph which many of you might have seen. I think you are basically, somebody might have shown you this graph while lecturing something, that the global temperatures are constantly on the rise. But see, friends, this is half the story. The actual graph is this, that since sometimes in 97, slightly more 2000 something, the temperatures have actually started coming down. Nobody talks about it. While this carbon dioxide goes on increasing, but the temperatures are coming down. Next one. Now see, you might have read in some of your geography classes or some in the biology classes that life started some 600 million years ago, visible life. That is, the first fossils appeared. So I have first taken a window. Window is a time slot from present to 542 million years. What is normally presented as 5-6 history, during which we have a record of inferred temperatures. This delta O18 is the way, by technique, isotopic technique, by which we can infer temperatures using some of the very small organisms, which you call as microfossils, which live in the ocean floor, and they, when they die, they sink to the bottom of the sea. And when we take those samples and use those samples, then we can tell you about this, the temperature at which this rock was formed, or when these, that is all intricate science. But this is, we do. My point of showing this graph is just to demonstrate to you that the temperatures on the planet Earth have never ever been stable. They have smaller fluctuations. You can see them moving up and down, up and down, up and down. At least for the last 542 million years, this has been happening. And When this has been happening, you see that there is an average, and even on an average, temperatures have been going up and down, up and down, and so on. So this is, whatever we write here is the research paper on the basis of which this data is presented. I don't say anything based on my own. What I'm simply doing is taking data from scientific research and presenting it in a new light for your advantage or for your sort of opinion. Now that was 542 million years because life started, or visible life, large scale life started. In fact, the older life started long back, maybe 3.8 billion years ago. That is long back. But the life started, and then this is for 65 million years. Why 65 million years? Because this is the beginning of a lot. There were dinosaurs. There was volcanic eruptions, the formation of the Deccan Plateaus, and India had started colliding with Tibet. You might have read somewhere that Himalaya is a product of a collision between two continents, Indian continent and the Tibetan continent. So it started at about 65 million years ago. And so we have taken this sort of smaller time scale, relatively speaking, because 65 million years, as far as humanly speaking, is too long a time scale. Okay. Again, you can see that the temperatures have been rising, falling, all sorts of things have been happening. And when you come closer and closer to the present, this is zero is present. This is, the temperatures have been going down. And then ancestors, whom we call by the name of Ororin Tugelensis, he started living here somewhere 6 million years ago. So obviously, if humans are responsible, why the temperatures have been fluctuating before 6 million years ago? That question has to be answered by the scientist, which no scientist does. Coming to much smaller scale, 6 million years. Why 6 million years? Because we, our predecessors of human beings, they came on this planet Earth about 6 million years ago. This is after a research paper by Petrie et al, 1999. And again, you see that the temperatures have been constantly fluctuating, but the overall trend is on a decline. It is on a decline because human civilization has flourished in a glacial period, and in a glacial cycle, there is an interglacial. That means glacial is a cold period in Earth's history, and interglacial is a relatively warmer period. So we are living in a relatively warmer period in a cold period. So I just want to demonstrate to you that the temperatures have been ever fluctuating, as you can see from these graphs. To the next one. In spite of all this, what you see as the mainstream thesis, both by politicians and the media, we are warming the planet, and unless we act, we can expect even more extreme weather, more heat waves, more flooding, more powerful storms, and more drought. Who said this? And now I will demonstrate to you that how it is the politics which comes in all sorts of these scientific questions, particularly the questions of environment. This was stated by none other than the best political face of the global warming protagonist and the author producer of the much publicized documentary film, An Inconvenient Truth. Al Gore, the Nobel laureate Al Gore, was responsible for this. For stating this, he stated this. But the inconvenient truth, essentially, Mr. Gore, is that a large number of industries that make devices which are used to control pollution, almost in many of the corporations, Al Gore controls more than 60% of the shares. So it is in the interest of Al Gore to push a hypothesis of global warming because of human-induced carbon dioxide. And then you look at any of the protocols, be it the Kyoto Protocol or Bali Protocol or Paris Protocol, whatever you protocol would come. The prescription for carbon dioxide, that is in a nutshell all about what you will hear at the end of all these conferences, all money wasted with one country. Now, the graph I showed you in the beginning, that is by Mann et al., this was corrected by two scientists. The data was filtered. Now, these are all advanced scientific techniques. And they said that the data Mann et al. Presented was corrected by McIntyre and McKittrick in 2003. That was 1998. And this was the original graph, this light gray line. And the corrected version is this one. This dark one is the corrected version. It has been published in a research journal by the name of Energy and Environment. And remember, friends, you are not in the game of science. We know this, and in fact, all scientists know this, that how difficult it is to publish something which is counter to the mainstream hypothesis or the mainstream scientific idea. And again, history is replete with examples when scientists were actually punished for not agreeing to what either the church was saying or what the particular political group was saying or any number of things. Okay, so what you see from this graph is something very interesting. The temperatures that you see in 2080 are somewhat lower than those that existed in 1480. Excuse me. So that means the earlier graph was tempered, and this is the current graph, because this time nobody questioned this paper. And this is a later paper. Okay, so you know that later evidence is this, that the temperatures that were close to 1400 AD have been almost very similar to what has been happening in 2000 AD. Perhaps they were a bit warmer. Now I come to the historical evidence. So as I said to you that we live in ice age, and within this ice age there are fluctuations. And within these fluctuations there are some warm periods and some cold periods. Warm period is medieval warm period, cold periods are which we call as little ice ages. Now this is from this AD, so this is the birth of Christ, and we come to the present 2000 here. Now this is the period of medieval warm period, as we say in history. And this was a period of plenty. Civilizations flourished, most of the Europe flourished, and civilization all over the world flourished during this time. And it was a time that because of the warming, the ice cap, the global North Pole cap, it receded. That means it shrunk. And when it shrunk, Vikings, they are actually dwellers of Sweden. There are some sort of nomads. They arrived in Greenland at this time, close to this, almost 1000 AD ago. And then as the ice cap, because of the little ice state, started increasing, the cover started increasing. So the cover of the ice cap was very low at this time. And because it was low ice cap, people were able to reach Greenland, and in them, Vikings used to live there. And then those, and covering more and more part of the Greenland, though these Vikings could not return back, and all of them perished, they died there. And then there was a little ice age. Friends, I don't know how much of literature and history is taught to you, but if you look at this, this is the period of real agony for the whole of Europe. This is known as the Dark Ages. During these Dark Ages, there are all sorts of war, because it is during the warm period that there is a growth of food, there is plenty. And during the ice ages, there is lack of food in Europe. But because it is at the higher latitudes, they are colder climates. They require higher temperatures for the crops to be cultivated and harvest. So during this period, from 1400 to 1800, all sorts of problems occurred there. This included the wars, the plague, and they are the Dark Ages. And those of you who ever become interested in literature or history would realize that how important these Dark Ages are. So I take a historical example. So remember what I have done? I have taken a geological example. I started from 560 million years and shown that from 560 million years to present, the temperature have been fluctuating. Then I took a smaller window, 6.5 million years, demonstrated again that the temperatures have been fluctuating without any human interference. Then I took a still smaller period of about 6 million years, 5.5 to be precise, and again demonstrated that the temperatures have been fluctuating, whereas humans, or we, came to this planet barely 6 million years ago, and those people, our poor forefathers, had not even fire at that time. So I don't know before that if anybody was responsible, at least the human beings were not responsible for all these fluctuations. Now I'll come to a Maldives story. So you know that Maldives is their islands are here. And see, this visual is very nice. It gives you a feeling of tranquility and everything. And then it makes a interesting video, because then you can make all sorts of gossips and say that if the seawater rises to by 2 meters, all these people would drown. Now, let us see what is the reality. Now, I think most of you have been at one time or the another to the Ganga Ghat. You know that during the monsoons, the Ganga River brings sand with it and deposits it on the banks of the river, on the ghats to be precise in the case of Banaras. It deposits it on either side because the ghats are cleaned every year. So you can see that they are deposited, and after the rains recede, it has to be cleaned and cleared. Only then the ghats take their normal look, and all this has to be cleaned with all sorts of techniques. Now, similarly, but here in Maldives, nobody was removing what the sea left. And that I show here is this, that this is the oldest sea level, the sediment deposited by oldest time, then the younger, and then the this is the present sea level. So if the water level is constantly coming down, how do we talk about the rise? For last so many years, almost 11,700 years, they have been constantly going down, not up. Okay. Now, there are other evidence for this. There are two islands by the name of Thinadu and Felidu, between which the rivers used to pass. So between these two, there's a gap in ocean. And through this gap, the dhonis would pass straight away in 1970s and 1980s. And these dhonis have nothing to do with cricket. They are the small boats which are there. It was only possible because unless this water level is shallow, it cannot pass. If it is high, only then the rivers, the boats can pass. So, but what happened? But now it has become shallower. So if it has become shallower, that means the ocean level has gone down. That is, sea level has gone down. Next one. This was dated at 1200 years before present. And this fossil has shown that this reef woman was buried. Now, for a fossil to survive, it must be buried under water. That means when this, at 1200 years before present, when this woman died, it was underwater. And then, because it is exposed today on the surface, that means unless the water level goes down, this fossil cannot come up. There can be a large number of other evidence. I'm not quoting. Now, what was the conclusion of this study? The study was made by Mohner. See what they state. In our study of the coastal dynamics and geomorphology of the shores, we were unable to detect any traces of a recent sea level rise. On the contrary, we found quite clear morphological indications of a recent fall in sea level. That is 20 to 30 centimeters in the last 30 years. Ever heard about this from the experts? Similar stories are also from many other places, including New Zealand. I am not going to that. But I'll show you something more interesting. This is the Greenland ice cover. And in this Greenland ice cover, the present data shows that the ice is accumulating at the rate of 5.4 plus minus 0.2 centimeter. This was published in a journal name of Science It is one of the most prestigious journals of science. And the other data was published for Geophysical Research Letters, equally prestigious. Both in the North Pole and in the South Pole, the ice caps are getting more and more snow. So if they are getting more and more snow, friends, let us understand that how is it so that they are sort of shrinking. Some shrinkage is part of iceberg sort of morphology. So I cannot go into that, but then I'll give you another example. This is a study published very recently, 2016. That means 2016 December, that is almost 2017. So barely 4 years ago. And what they show is this, that during Pleistocene, it's an older time, about 2.6 million years ago, the ice cover, this blue thing is an ice cover. Greenland had only this much ice cover. Then you have ice cover constantly increasing. And at 11,700 million years ago, it was covering the whole of the Greenland. So friends, even the ice cover has constantly been shrinking, sort of advancing. It is all a matter of nature. I'll not talk about this. I'll leave this as well. Now, there is no clear discernible effect of human activities on global temperature. And geology is a temporal science. That means geology essentially is dealing with the time dimension of the earth, and what was happening through time to these rocks, to the earth, is what we address ourselves to. You must understand that natural earth systems are always in flux. They are disequilibrium. And life itself survives and thrives in such disequilibriums. Now, this is another graph. Pluto is rising. As far as you see this part of the graph. So this red thing is black thing is CO2 and red thing is the temperature. So both are increasing together, but this is only part of the graph. If I show the whole graph, then the global temperatures are constantly fluctuating and CO2 level is constantly increasing. I, for one, or any other scientist, cannot see a correlation between this line, which is clearly increasing, and this line, which is constantly fluctuating. Any correlation between these two, as far as I am concerned, is not honest. I could prove this by several other examples, but therefore more intricate. It is just, let me tell you that, because I think a student of intermediate should understand this. It's not very difficult. See, it is also important that on at which part of the graph you are looking at. Suppose you look at this part, then global temperatures are in decline. If I look at this part, they're almost, so at this part, they're increasing. And you can choose a way and you can talk about whatever you want. So that is how statistics lies to people. So I would like to bring to you before you the real climate question. You have to separate the issues. The question is not, is the climate changing? It constantly is, based on geological and historical data. It is like warmer now in 1880. Global warming exists, but global cooling will follow. But the debatable question is, do humans control Earth's dynamic climate system, or does nature through normal physical processes? And even if you are able to say so-called control these carbon dioxide, now these effective cuts, if you control 83% of the cuts by 2050, you would be reducing temperatures by, I'll show this in a next slide. Yes, this one. So this is the difference of temperature that you will achieve. I don't say there is no control, but the control is very minor. At this point, I would also say that even if you keep reducing 83% carbon dioxide, the temperatures will be reduced only by 0.1 or 0.2 degrees Celsius, imperceptible. That doesn't mean that I say that go for a plunder of the earth. But this bogey has to be realized. Now I'll show you, I think for you, it must be the last slide. As far as the basic argument is concerned, this argument continue for on and on and on. I have a large number of slides. I've been working with this for a very long time. But this slide for me is very important. See, this 22 degrees, this line is temperature line. The temperatures go down. These are the glacial ages. Comes up, stabilizes, goes down, again bounces back, stays there, goes down, bounces back. It is going down. Density of the Earth is 22 degrees Celsius whenever. But the control of climate control is such that glaciers are advancing. So we have come to a lower temperature. That is, the Earth is cooling as far as the overall picture on a longer time scale is concerned. And friends, I would like to draw your attention for one more thing. This black thing is carbon dioxide. Today we are crying foul about 400 ppm, or less than 400 ppm. And we have all sorts of theories that this will happen if it is 400 ppm. This will happen, that will happen. But remember, as far as the Earth is concerned, the carbon dioxide has been 7,000 parts per million in Cambrian, when all life sprang on this planet. This is the GeoCarb III project and big business. I also take one more. This carbon dioxide line, this is one, this is the period known as geology as Carboniferous and Devonian. When this Carboniferous, the name itself signifies that some, it has to do something with the carbon. Yes, it has. And that it is during this period that most of the coal deposits of the world were deposited. And when most of the coal deposits of the world were deposited, they sucked all the carbon dioxide through those plants which were buried underwater and which you today get as coal. But friends, for argument's sake, if you burn all of your fossil fuels, which I don't suggest, but for argument's sake, I'm saying that even if you burn all fossil fuels, then you can extrapolate, you will get only to these carbon dioxide levels, nothing more. So that means you cannot go above the carbon dioxide levels which the Earth has already experienced. Second thing, again, I would like to repeat, is that average global temperature is 22 degrees Celsius. Whatever you do as human beings, you cannot reverse the process. There are environmental issues, I agree. The issues are like water, in which your school has worked commendably. That is the more important issue. And that will be the issue in coming time. Because global warming, nobody can avert. With global warming, the problem is this, that there will be climate change. And if I feel it is natural, or even if you say that it is not natural, that is a bigger question to be tackled. And the second question is that of constantly dwindling supply in Ganga of the water. So if we want to not become Mohenjo-daro and Harappa or Sindhu River, we have to tackle those things also. Now, I'll not tackle this. So what I simply demonstrated, that there is really no apparent correlation between carbon dioxide levels and global temperature. Ice ages, when carbon dioxide has been as much as 10 to 15 times higher than modern levels. For example, these are the geological periods in the end Ordovician ice age. There have been times when temperature was increasing, but carbon dioxide was decreasing, and times when CO2 was increasing, but temperature was decreasing. See, friends, if we have evidence both ways, that when temperature is increasing and carbon dioxide is decreasing, and times when CO2 is increasing and temperature is decreasing, what sort of correlation you are talking about? I don't understand. So can we demonstrate that greenhouse gas rises precedes temperature rise, thus inferring them as a driver? In the first place, friends, ask any expert who comes to you, to your school, delivers a lecture, ask one simple question. And that question is that, is there an experiment to prove that CO2 raises temperature? Friends, you will be surprised to learn that all this debate is there. Enormous money is being spent into this without a single experiment. All these scientists, botanists, etc., etc., together could not produce one experiment to demonstrate that CO2 is responsible for increasing experiment in the lab cannot do it. Then what I have shown you is the evidence from the laboratory earth. That is the only evidence that is available. The inference is yours. I have some time because I have to leave a bit early. Whatever I can cover, I would quickly cover this. These are two, one of surface temperature. Surface temperature is actually what we call as SST, that is sea surface temperature, that is known as the global temperature. So this graph was available of surface temperature. And this was for the carbon dioxide. What I have done is that I have simply done, played a small mischief. I have drawn these red lines on this graph. And this is the peak of carbon dioxide, CO2 peak, CO2. And this is the temperature peak. If you look at this graph, it is the temperature peak which comes first, and then the CO2 peak. And you can understand what this all means. So there is an average of 400 years lag of cause after effect. This is talking about glaciers. I don't know whether I should go into this on and on because I think I have already demonstrated what I wanted to say. And for school children, I will be only confusing things more. But I think my message has been loud and clear. And in the remaining time, if you please, I would be willing to answer any questions that you have. So if you feel so, I would revert back to
Thank you, sir, for such an enlightening session. I'm sure our students are eager to ask questions from Professor Mallikarjun. So I request Mrs. Rupali Arora to conduct the question answer round.
Good evening, sir. Our students are eagerly waiting for their doubts to be solved. So without further delay, I would like to call Priyanshu Mukherjee of class 8B to ask his question.
Good evening, sir. Sir, I have a question. Which greenhouse gas is more important to Earth's rising temperature, water vapor or CO2?
Water vapor. Water vapor. And that is a question which I did not touch because of the paucity of time. It is essentially water vapor which is more important. It is more important than carbon dioxide.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, our next question is from Amritesh Pandey, class 9.
Good evening, sir. Sir, I want you to ask this question. I want to ask this question. What role does the ocean play in global warming? Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
That's a big topic. It will come. See, ocean water essentially does one thing, which is the heat is transferred from the between equator and the pole through, as you already know, maybe by the ocean currents, the warm currents and the cold currents. The warm and cold currents are responsible for transferring the heat from the equator to your poles, both north poles and south poles. So, and apart from that, ocean also has a very important role, that of stabilizing the temperature. So whenever there's enormous heat, there's more water vapor, the more the water vapor, there are more cloud formation. And from this cloud formation, you have eventually the precipitation, that is what you call as rain, coming to the surface, which decreases temperature. So they have a great stabilizing role. In very short, but the answer is very, very long.
Thank you, sir.
Shivansh Margia of class 9 is here to ask his question.
Good morning, sir. I am Shivansh Malviya from class 9A, and my question to you is, hasn't the earth warmed and cooled throughout the history naturally?
I can't hear you somehow. Yes, try.
Sir, I repeat my question. Sir, hasn't the earth warmed and cooled throughout the history naturally?
Yes, it has. That is all I demonstrated.
Thank you, sir.
Nilisha Shankar. Next question is from Nilisha Shankar, class 9B.
Good evening, sir. I have a question. What scientific evidence exists that Earth is warming and that humans are the main cause?
There is no evidence. There is evidence that Earth is warming, but humans are warming the Earth. For this, there is little evidence, at least not the one I know of. The only evidence is one propagated by some scientists. That it is carbon dioxide which is responsible. But this is largely a conjecture. Conjecture means it's a hypothesis. And friends, you will also appreciate that this was because most of the environment area was dominated by botanists. And botanists are not our scientists in that. They work with plants. And it's a very small part of the system. Of course, they cover a large area. And they have a role in stabilizing the temperatures. But so they had to find something which makes their field more important. See, as I told you earlier, that science is not a very objective venture. And nobody tells you this, nobody taught me either, that there is a debate in science. And science also has a point of view. Scientists have their own prejudices. So what was happening is that because most of the environmental sciences were being controlled by botanists, so they thought that this CO2 thing should be the most important. But there are a large number of political economic reasons. And if very quickly, I will say, see, this is essentially a political economic issue. And this political economic issue emerged because it was a time when Margaret Thatcher was the Prime Minister of UK. And this was a time that England has lost its hold. The job situation in England was going down from worse to worse. And during this time, there was one bright MP of Margaret Thatcher who said that, well, Mrs. Thatcher is an honors in chemistry. If I hand her over a scientific question, maybe we can regain our hold on the international field. This was a time when the empire was shrinking. I think you will not be knowing this. This was a time when, for no reason, England attacked hapless people of Falkland. There was an island, line of people were killed just to establish their superiority. In the process, this carbon dioxide was a debate by Arrhenius, which was tested and buried long back. This was exhumed. Exhumed is the word which we use for digging out a skeleton from the grave. So the hypothesis was exhumed and handed over to Mrs. Thatcher. And Mrs. Thatcher, obviously, because she was a chemistry honors, she knew more science. And most of the politicians the world over are mostly illiterate, even today. So this point of view, nobody was a challenger. So America started this bogey of Al Gore, and but the rest is all history. I cannot go into detail of this because there are a large number of things to be said. But by and large, this was the beginning. There is no scientific beginning of the whole thing.
Thank you, sir.
Another question is from Shailja Mishra of class 10B.
A very good evening, sir. Sir, I have a question that how will global warming harm our natural and agricultural resources?
Oh, good. It not necessarily harms. There are a large number of crops. Because, see, all of you must have read about photosynthesis some stage. What is photosynthesis? From carbon dioxide, plants make their food. Am I correct or not?
Yes, sir.
So if they make their food from carbon dioxide, then the more the merrier. The more carbon dioxide, more food. Yes or no?
So we can.
If the answer is yes, then carbon dioxide increases. Yes, you see, right? The carbon dioxide increases a large number of crops. It does harm some crops. So don't worry. Even the levels grow very high, maybe we have to slightly change our habits. Maybe you have to eat more rice or more some other grain, but we'll not be short of food. Don't worry about that.
Thank you, sir.
So our last question from Sukriti of class 10B.
Yes, please.
Good evening, sir. I wanted to raise a question that do you also exert a cooling effect on the Earth's climate?
I could not hear your question properly. Please
okay,
repeat.
I'm repeating. I'm saying that do humans also exert a cooling effect on the Earth's climate?
Humans have as much cooling effect on Earth's climate as much they have effect on cooling climate of Mars, Saturn, and Jupiter. No. Humans are too insignificant to do that. But the point is that we must not plunder this earth. We have only one. And carbon dioxide is not the only issue. This may be a bogey. There are much bigger issues. Bigger issues are the destruction of environment. And the environmental destruction essentially is a consequence of the exploitation of the earth. And what is responsible for the exploitation of the earth? It is not the science, it is the social science which is responsible. How? Because if the society is such today that the only one and one aim is to earn money at any cost, how ask an industrialist to sacrifice his interest and preserve environment and not make profit? This is impossible. So long as the present system continues, the industrialist cannot be controlled. And if the degradation of the environment is not done by the people who, well, they throw some plastic, etc., etc., they can be recovered. That is a municipality job. But the larger damage is being done. See, whole areas are being devastated by mining. Whole areas are devastated by, they are being robbed of the forest, the corporate farming. In fact, there is evidence that this coronavirus also started because of a plunder of the earth, because of the spread of the forest. The large number of geographers in America who believe this. And this is all very recent thing. So this plunder of the earth is essentially, see, what plunders villagers will do. A villager requires some, say, fodder from the, because they also use plant leaves as fodder from the forest, or he or she wants some sort of this lumber and timber from the forest. That's a small quantity. But look at what happens in the paper mill. In Uttarakhand, there is a paper mill by the name of Lal Kua area. And you can see truck after truck simply moving into that paper factory and producing this. So they are more dangerous. So the answer, I think, is very simple.
Thank you very much, sir.
That was all for today, sir. Thank you so much for patiently listening our student and solving their queries.
Thank you very much, so kind of you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
I now invite Mr. Vinay Prakash Singh to propose the vote of thanks.
Gratitude is an attitude that takes us to altitude, to be spiritually conscious, socially responsible, and morally upright is the core dimension of our school. We raise our hearts in gratitude and thanks Almighty for blessing us with the delightful evening. We wish to express our gratitude to our honorable keynote speaker, Professor Dr. Mallikarjun Joshi sir, Dean, Faculty of Science, Department of Geology, BHU. Thank you, sir, for being with us today and sharing such useful information, which I am sure will benefit us all. Our school has proved its standard over the years as a reliable source of inspiration, even as it continues to inform, form, and transform its students' community. The credit goes to the parents too. Thank you, parents, for being the key players in our success story. We extend our sincere thanks to our principal ma'am, Dr. Anita Paulinde, and manager, sir, Mr. Pradeep Kumar Day, for awakening the desires and wonders in young generation and sharpening the educational agenda. Dear ma'am and sir, your actions inspire others as you explore the possibilities and help us to reach new horizons. I also express my gratitude to Pratyasha ma'am for guiding us constantly and coordinator ma'am for helping us line up everything. As well as I also express my gratitude to our technical team for unconditional support. Thank you once again and wish you a happy and restful weekend.
Just one thing I want to say. I would request the students not to write in examination what I say if you want to get good grades. Because grades, getting grades is dependent on your textbooks. What I tell you is that you should become a good human being, a good scientist. That is postponed for a later date. But you must be exposed at this stage to what the reality is and how science is biased. But don't write what I have said. Because if you write these things, you will get almost a good black, big, as we say, zero. And that is not what I want. I want to enlighten you. It is not a part of the syllabus. It is not the course. It is something, it is a point of view. So, thank you.